Okay. Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming to today's moot court. My name is Liz. I'm the chair of the Student Animal Legal Defense Fund. And I'm going to do a quick intro of our participants today. So I'm really excited to introduce the Honorable Robert Smith. He is the associate judge at the Newark Court of Appeals. He graduated from Stanford University and Columbia Law School, where he was the editor-in-chief of the Law Review. In 2003, he was appointed by Governor Pataki to the Court of Appeals. And he has also taught at the Cardozo Law School. I don't think that Professor Richard Epstein really needs an introduction for anyone in this room. But obviously, he is an expert in many, many areas of law, including Roman law, as we always hear. And he has written many books, and we're very excited that he could join us on the bench today. And then our counsel is Professor Roderick Hills, who specializes in constitutional law with an emphasis on doctrines governing federalism. His particular focus is on the problems and promise of the decentralization of regulation in this country. Professor Hills has served as a law clerk on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit and was a faculty member at Michigan Law before coming to NYU. And then our other counsel today is Professor Catherine Sharkey, who is one of the nation's leading scholars on punitive damages and federal preemption in the realm of products liability. Professor Sharkey was the recipient of the Podell Distinguished Teaching Award at NYU, and she has clerked for Judge Calabresi of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit and for Justice Souter on the U.S. Supreme Court. She's also worked as a Supreme Court and Appellate Litigation Associate before joining the faculty at Columbia and then here at NYU. So today's case is one that's facing the Supreme Court sometime in the next year. It focuses on the possible federal preemption of a California law that bans the slaughter and inhumane treatment of downer or non-ambulatory animals in federally regulated slaughterhouses. And lots of you have both the California and the federal language in front of you. So the Pork Industries Trade Association filed suit against the state of California, seeking injunctive relief barring the application of this ban, claiming that the law was preempted by the Federal Meat Inspection Act. The district court granted the injunction. On appeal, the Ninth Circuit found that the Federal Meat Inspection Act did not expressly preempt the California statute. Further, the court found that although the trade association might win on the merits of the case, they did not demonstrate irreparable harm or that the balance of hardships to the industry favored injunctive relief. So the structure of today's Supreme Court moot is as follows. Each side is given 30 minutes. For all argument. The justices will then deliberate, and if they would like to, can deliver a verdict. Following that, we'll do a brief discussion of the case, and then we should have time for a Q&A. Okay.
Great.
Okay. All right, shall we please rise?
We rise too?
All persons having business before the Honorable Supreme Court of the United States are admonished to draw near and give their attention, for the court is now sitting. God save the United States and this honorable court. Please be seated.
You're the chief.
Okay. Well, I need to know the name of the case. National Meat Association against Harris.
It's actually Brown.
No, it's Brown. No, it's Harris in the Supreme Court. It's Brown and the Pigs. It is. There are some associate justices who are particularly hard to keep under control. Okay. Mr. Hills, go ahead when you're ready.
May it please the court, Mr. Chief Justice. My name is Roderick Hills, and I represent the petitioner in this case. I would like to reserve the last 5 minutes of my time for rebuttal.
You have it.
I take this case to be a fairly straightforward case of interpreting an express preemption clause. That clause, 21 U.S.C. Section 678, has three requirements that could be drawn into dispute, but all of them are, I think, when read in light of traditional canons and principles of statutory construction, straightforward. First, a state law is preempted if it falls within the scope of the Federal Meat Inspection Act. Second, it's preempted if it also is with respect to covered slaughterhouses, premises, facilities, and operations. And third, to show preemption, you must show that the state law is in addition to or different than federal requirements.
There are a couple of Court of Appeals cases, the Cavell and the Empacadora cases, which I gather you're not telling us those were wrongly decided.
No, I would say that those cases fall squarely outside of the preemption clause. I would suggest that those cases are distinguishable because the state laws at issue in those cases don't fall within the scope of the Federal Meat Inspection Act.
How do you tell?
I think that the best way to read scope, again, in light of very hoary old principles of statutory construction, is to think of state laws falling within the scope if it falls within the mischief that the federal law addresses. The federal law addresses two kinds of evils or mischiefs, to use Cook's old phrase. One is adulterated meat, and the other is the inhumane treatment of animals because of the method by which they are handled.
And you're saying that that was not true in those horse meat cases?
No. You can imagine any number of state laws that forbid various treatment of animals or use of animals in slaughterhouses that would fall wholly outside the mischief of the federal statute. An easy example would be a state law that barred the slaughtering of an animal because it was highly intelligent or it was a natural companion of humans. Such a state law is directed to...
Does that include a horse?
What?
Does that include a horse?
Only if you grew up in the age of Trigger and Black Beauty. But, some lawmakers' memories extends far back to time immemorial when horses were regarded as the natural companions of cowboys and actors. And so... It seems that...
Am I really following the drift of this particular argument that whenever we look at a particular species, if they want to ban horses, they're smart, so you can dandle that, but if you wanted to do the same thing with pigs, since they're close to the ground, the preemption would apply?
If the state, in its wisdom, wants to ban a species because
I mean,
it thinks...
The slaughter of the species.
Yeah, any species, or even a breed within the species.
What if a state wants to go vegetarian and prohibit the slaughter of meat?
Absolutely. It would be...
That's okay.
Absolutely squarely...
But they can't prohibit the slaughter of downer pig. Yes.
No, absolutely, because it all depends upon what the federal law, the evil that the federal law is trying to address. The federal law is not trying to address the debate between vegetarianism and eating meat. The federal law is trying to address cruelty arising from the handling of animals. If the state is addressing an entirely different evil... An evil, say, about the immorality of eating meat or the immorality of killing man's best friend, then those fall outside the evil of the statute. The best analogy I can make is imagine if state troopers from California raided a slaughterhouse to liberate animals branded with a particular brand, horses or cows, because they believed that these animals belonged to someone other than the person who sold them to the slaughterhouse. They were stolen animals. In that case...
So that would be okay, wouldn't it?
Absolutely. Because the federal law is not designed to deal with theft. Likewise, this federal law.
You mentioned ends. There's also the question of means. One of the standard tests that you have in preemption cases is whether the internal operations of federally regulated facilities will be impaired by the actions in question. Now, if we start having sheriffs from 14 different states going into these various places, holding things up and taking animals out, aren't we going to run into the problem of disruption? And I think the point here is more important than perhaps the jokes may let on, because if you just look at purpose, it seems to me that you're going to underestimate the complexities associated with this situation. And so I don't know why you're trying to argue for the other side on this one, but it seems to me that the preemption case would surely cover anything that disrupted the internal operations or the way in which the system went.
Well, the way I like to think of the case is by looking at the text of the preemption clause and not disruption to the federal system. Disruption to the federal system might indeed ensue if, for instance, state troopers tried to recover stolen cattle, but it would strain belief to believe that this statute, which is designed to prevent adulterated meat from entering commerce, and uses the term purpose in its very clauses to circumscribe the scope of its two prohibitions in 603A and B, it's the purpose of the statute specifically says that it is, and I would like to read the provision. Installing the examination of animals for the purpose of preventing the use and commerce of adulterated meat and for the purpose of preventing the inhumane slaughtering of livestock.
Okay, well, the federal statute is directed at inhumane treatment in the slaughterhouse.
Yes.
The state, I assume, obviously can regulate inhumane treatment outside of the slaughterhouse.
Well, the question becomes, what is inside and outside? And again, in light of the text of the statute.
Well, but in principle, obviously, the state can prohibit a farmer from doing bad things to his pigs in his own farm.
If the statute so says. And yes. The federal statute in 603B, discussing the humane methods of slaughter, says that the secretary shall cause to be made an examination and inspection of the method by which cattle are handled in connection with slaughter. In connection with...
So you're not giving me the idea that the farmer can treat his... that the state can regulate how the farmer... Is it a farmer who raises these pigs? How the farmer can treat his pigs.
It all depends upon the definition, the reasonable definition of in connection with. Now, I take a truck immediately outside the slaughterhouse to be in connection with the slaughterhouse, if that truck is indeed
destined.
But what about
the truck at the other end before it sets out on its journey for the slaughterhouse?
In its wisdom, the Federal Food Inspection Service has only tried to interpret in connection with in a reasonable way,
but these non-ambulatory pigs. As I understand what some of the respondents are saying here. They're saying that their problem results from maltreatment before the slaughterhouse ever heard of them. That's indeed probably the great majority of them. Mm-hmm.
And so if the state were to enact a law that was directed against common carriers or against farmers, such a law would not be preempted even under the terms of the interpretation
It can't prohibit the slaughterhouse from buying the animals from the people who maltreated them?
I think the critical inquiry,
is that a yes or a no?
If the purpose of the state law, the mischief against which the state law is directed, is indeed controlling abusive animals on trains, trucks, or on farms. Absolutely.
How do we know that's not the purpose of this one?
The purpose of this statute leaps out both in terms of how the respondents have characterized it, and the respondents in this case were indeed the sponsors of the measure in California, and how it's written. The challenged preempted provisions are written entirely in terms of slaughterhouses as the lead. No slaughterhouse shall process, butcher, or sell. No slaughterhouse shall hold a non-ambulatory animal without taking immediate action. Now, 599 FA does say no slaughterhouse, stockyard, auction, market, or agency or dealer shall buy sell.
This is an amazing oral argument. So far, you spent 90% of your time explaining the things that are not preempted, right?
Yes.
I take it your position is actually this one is preempted.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely, Your Honor.
Could you tell me not about the ones that aren't, but rather about the ones that are?
Yeah, well, take for instance, as a hypothetical, 599F.
Let's take this case.
599F is clearly directed towards, and makes no pretense of being directed towards anything else, but the treatment of animals in the transition
that's the one that the Court of Appeals held preempted.
Yes.
And there's no cross petition, so that's not directly an issue here? Or is there a cross petition?
Repeat the question, Your Honor.
As you understand it, does your adversary challenge that holding?
The one at the end of the case.
No, as far as I know,
okay.
No. So in this case, we have a law that is entirely... The gravamen of the law, the center of the law, is directed against slaughterhouses. The events that inspired the law were abuse at slaughterhouses.
But if the statute said no slaughterhouse can buy a stolen cow, you wouldn't say there's anything wrong with that.
Certainly not, because in that case, it's not merely that it's directed towards slaughterhouses. That's certainly one of three necessary requirements for preemption. One is that it must regulate the operations of a slaughterhouse. That is necessary. It is not sufficient.
Okay, but now the question this one. Why does this represent regulate the operations of slaughterhouse if, according to what Justice Kaczynski said, the only thing that it regulates is what animals that are in transit to slaughterhouses may reach it? So his attitude is operations are within, and what's going on in this particular case is stuff that happens prior to. Why is that, on a plain meaning reading of this statute, which is what you've been pushing, something which is manifestly incorrect?
Oh, because the operations in this case surely include inspection operations, inspecting cattle to determine whether they have an ailment or a disease could not be closer to the core operations regulated by this statute.
But it's the inspection of cattle that are to be shipped in interstate commerce, and if you kill all of these animals before they get into interstate commerce, why is it that the federal government has an interest in it?
Well, to the extent that the statute regulates animals lined up outside, destined for the slaughterhouse, it's surely regulating animals' method of handling
but
in
Mr.
connection
Hills,
with.
There's a difficulty with that. You are trying to take the case where at the gate, but as best I could read the statute, if it's anywhere along the process where these animals become downer animals and non-ambulatory, whether it's right at the gate or somewhere back on the trip, the appropriate situation seems to be, or at least California could argue, that that's the time at which this particular statute takes place, so that it takes place before those activities which are in connection with what is going on in the operations of the slaughterhouse. That is what I take it as the argument.
I take the language of the statute is that no slaughterhouse shall receive a non-ambulatory animal is directed at slaughterhouses, and that clearly is directed at a method of handling animals.
Yes, but
in
all
connection
the
with.
Way back. In other words, if one of these animals went non-ambulatory the second it entered into California, presumably at that time the state could, under its own statute, decide that it's going to require them to be shot down.
Yeah,
so I don't understand how the question here turns on whether or not it's close to or far away from. The statute could be read under this view to allow you to slaughter any animal that is a downer animal so long as it's not on the premises or within 5 miles of the slaughterhouse. Mm. And you're arguing for a rather different position, which is total preemption.
Mm-hmm. I would say that if this statute were cured, I doubt that the applications were severable, but that's a question of state law, by deleting from 599F the term slaughterhouse and saying no stockyard, auction, market agency, or dealer.
What if the applications were found to be severable in that you sever the applications within from the applications outside the premises?
I think that that should be a matter for the agency to determine whether the distance from the premises
the
is
in... For the agency to determine?
Which agency?
To the extent that the agency is determining the ambit of the Federal Meat Inspection Act, I would assume that the agency can define a phrase like in connection with. And if it determines that a state law is regulating the position of animals that are lined up outside
of has the agency done anything of the sort?
Yes, indeed. It has a regulation that defines a directive, I should say, not passed through notice and comment, but nevertheless, we would argue entitled to at least Skidmore deference, that defines in connection with to mean lined up in trucks outside of a slaughterhouse. And that is where the federal statute, preempts the state law.
Explain to me again regulating animals lined up in trucks outside of the slaughterhouse impinges on the federal power to regulate what happens inside the slaughterhouse.
Well, for instance, you really can't, if your two concerns are the humane movement of animals, it's extremely difficult, as I think Marshall would say in Gibbons v. Ogden, to regulate the movement to the point Y, unless you have some capacity to monitor the item being moved at point X where it begins. So it would be very difficult for these meat inspectors to figure out who's non-ambulatory unless they can look at the animals before they start moving.
Let me ask a simple question. Are you representing, do you think, the government, or are you representing the meat packers?
Well, in this case, I think that my paycheck's coming from the National Meat Association.
Well, I think that it sounds like it's coming from the government because the meat packers essentially would want to make sure that the entire distribution chain from start to finish is in fact controlled by the federal government, even if the federal government is willing to cede some portion of it.
So suppose
we require you, in effect, now to be more faithful to your employer rather than to your amicus, how are you going to alter the argument to make sure that what they're worried about is there going to be a lot of animals, this is their claim, is it not, that will be declared non-ambulatory, which in fact can be revived and sold into slaughter, and that would be true whether or not these animals were caught at the border of California or outside the gate. And if the government's position is at the border, they can slaughter them, that's not what your client wants, is it?
But unfortunately, I have to be faithful to the statute as well. And the statute is fairly clear in saying that it regulates methods of handling in connection with slaughterhouses. Mm-hmm. And the agency has reasonably construed this to mean animals which are on the verge of going into a slaughterhouse. The statute exempts from this comprehensive preemption more stringent regulation, purely intrastate slaughtering. Section 661 gives California the right to regulate that aspect. And it would be a strain to say that simply because an animal may or may not someday be destined for a slaughterhouse, therefore this statute as written applies to that animal. But I want to get back to your central question of why it is that regulating the type of an animal is regulating the operations of a facility. It seems to me that if you define the type in terms of an inspectable condition of the animal, you are essentially saying that you are going to create a duplicate system.
An inspectable condition? So, yeah, well, of course, you have to inspect it to tell whether it's a horse or not, too. But you don't have to, you're saying that's a pretty easy inspection.
It's not an inspection that the federal law undertakes, and that's the critical difference. Federal law has a detailed method of regulating, both in the statute and in the regs, whether an animal is non-ambulatory. As soon as that appears in the statute, as it does, and in the regs that implement the statute, those federal rules remove from any state consideration.
Wait a minute. The federal, as I remember, there's something in the federal statute that makes a distinction between a cow and a pig, too.
The federal statute refers to cattle, sheep, swine, goats, horses,
mules. I read somewhere that if it's a non-ambulatory cow, the federal regulation won't let you touch it because it might be a mad cow.
Yeah, the rules certainly draw that distinction. The statute, however, is specifically, and the rules are specifically addressed to whether an animal is ambulatory or non-ambulatory. As soon as federal law addresses that issue, it pulls it away from the states to discuss or deal with. And so for the states to define a type of animal in terms of the very ailment over which the feds have exclusive jurisdiction is to circumvent preemption through a pretext, which even I think the Ninth Circuit recognized in some cases.
Well, you're not really saying the feds have exclusive jurisdiction outside the slaughterhouse, are you?
No, because remember, there's three necessary.
You're basically giving the slaughterhouse a curtilage. You're saying that when the truck is outside the slaughterhouse, the federal regulation kicks in.
Precisely, Your Honor. But remember, that is certainly not sufficient. It's merely necessary for federal regulation.
But isn't the reality, isn't the point of California's regulation. If you say slaughterhouses can't buy this kind of pig, then the people aren't going to send them that kind of pig. Those pigs will never get near the slaughterhouse, and the vast majority of the problem will be solved without touching the slaughterhouse operation.
Yes, if it were fair to characterize California's law as addressing a matter unconnected to slaughterhouses, if that were a fair characterization of the mischief that the law addressed, you could argue that the law was not addressing the problem that the federal statute was addressing. It would be very much like a law against stolen horses. Unfortunately, I think that's not a fair characterization.
But you would acknowledge that a law that says you may not sell a stolen horse to a slaughterhouse would be a valid state law.
It would be suspicious if there was a federal law regulating stolen horses. There isn't
stolen horses in slaughterhouses.
Yeah, there is
So if there's a federal regulation that says don't slaughter any stolen horses,
right? And
I'm having a little trouble imagining under this statute, but then you say the state law that says you can't sell a stolen horse to a slaughterhouse would be preempted.
There would be a strong question to ask why they were singling out only slaughterhouses. It would be very odd that a state law would say, oh, we're concerned with the theft of horses and the fencing of horses and the rustling of horses generally. If they only mentioned slaughterhouses, the one subject was the topic of exclusive federal jurisdiction. And so in this case, because the overwhelming focus of the law ignores farmers entirely, there's no mention of producers, common carriers mostly, and largely seems directed at slaughterhouses.
The laws in those two, and then Cavell and Empacador, you're not saying that those were unconnected with slaughterhouses?
No, because remember, and I want to emphasize, because it's the critical part of the case, it's not sufficient for preemption that you regulate the operation of the slaughterhouse. You also must regulate for the purpose of interfering with the federal interest. And in this case, that would be interfering with the federally determined level of humanity in the method of handling of livestock.
Okay, now,
those animals were not concerned with those, pardon me, those state laws. The Illinois law was not concerned with a method of handling of horses. It was concerned with the characteristics of horses irrespective of their method of handling. And in that sense,
you don't think killing horses is a method of handling?
Well, in this case, the method of handling, reasonably interpreted in this statute, means the method by which they are moved from the process of being alive to the process of being dead. So I would assume that killing horses undoubtedly is bad, but it would be bad regardless of the means used under the Illinois law. If you were to play soft lullaby music to the horse and carefully euthanize it according to the highest standards of the Death with Dignity Act,
the legislature of California seems to think killing a downer pig is bad.
Yeah, yes. And they are not entitled to the extent that that law is motivated.
I'm sorry, I cut off Justice Epstein. Justice.
It's the first, but not the last time that this will happen. But I have a more naive question. Just Kaczynski down below, when he came to interpret the phrase type of animal, said that it would be futile to simply limit it to a kind of a species or a subspecies. Mm-hmm. He said that a type of animal could include a female within the species whom you could keep out of the slaughterhouse. Mm-hmm. Or it can infuse those animals above a certain size in the slaughterhouse. And so he then goes on, he says, so it could also treat as a type of species a non-ambulatory animal. And so the question that I would want to ask is, it seems to me he pitched his case on that particular point. Why is he wrong?
He's wrong because type of animal is really irrelevant. It is, if I may, a red herring.
Wait a second. It's the same red herring that we talked about in Cavell, where they were talking about horses as a species and that you could keep them out of the slaughterhouse.
If we read Judge Posner's opinion with care, he talked about the concern of the federal statute. He said the concern of the federal statute was to deal with methods of handling, of how animals were killed. And a ban, a total ban, irrespective of method, on the killing of horses is not concerned with that issue. Now, if you define type of animal in terms of a federally inspectable condition, like arthritic pig, even the Ninth Circuit, Judge Kaczynski's opinion, acknowledges that that would be circumventing the preemption clause in an illegitimate way, because that's an exclusive federal concern, how you inspect an ailment for the reasons of preventing pain to the animal or adulteration of the meat.
So you think a non-ambulatory pig and an arthritic pig are not distinguishable?
They're indistinguishable if the purpose of singling them out is to minimize pain to the animal, because the federal agency and the federal statute have exhaustively defined how to minimize that pain.
But suppose it turns out that what we do is we stress the question as to whether or not adulterated animals are going to be shipped into interstate commerce. At that particular point, it seems to me that the real danger that matters is that bad pigs or bad cows or bad animals get through, when in this particular case, that is not going to be implicated because you're keeping out animals, so by definition, more animals will be kept out of interstate commerce, and so there's no danger if you adopt the California statute that the adulterated animals can get through the sieve. So why does that not mean, in effect, that the statute is perfectly sensible because it lines up with the dominant purpose of this particular statute?
Because I don't think purpose can trump the text, and the text quite clearly says that all of the regulations in the federal statute, that is to say, the regulations under the Act, preempt. And some of the regulations have to do with more than adulterated meat. They have to do with setting the humane level of treatment. Put another way, the meat producers were able to get through Congress a law saying that their need to be humane should go so high and no higher.
But it's both a floor and a ceiling, you're saying.
Yes, precisely. It's a floor and a ceiling on humanity as well as adulteration. And so if you raise, as it were, the level of humanity above the federal level, you have violated the preemption clause and the purpose behind it, which is to guarantee to meat packers and producers a particular level of safety and care that they need not and cannot be forced to exceed.
But the reply to that would be that is absolutely true to the extent that animals get inside the slaughterhouse. Mm-hmm. But if you kill them humanely before they get in there, then in effect you don't have to worry about preemption because it's not an addition to or different than, as they grotesquely say, different from what's going on. Rather, it turns out what you're doing is you're simply saying we are controlling the things before they get into the slaughterhouse, and so all the stuff that have to do with regulations within the slaughterhouse are neither here nor there. Mm-hmm. So we agree with you. They would say that they could not tell you the method of slaughter once an animal gets into a slaughterhouse, but they can tell you the method of slaughter for animals that are cordoned off from the slaughterhouse. So why is that argument wrong?
Well, if the state of California is trying to define the method of handling animals in connection with their slaughter at a slaughterhouse, then they fall within, as the Chief Justice felicitously put it, the curtilage of the federally preempted area.
This then gets back to the point that under your view of the statute, if they stop these things 10 miles before they get into the state, they can enforce the statute, but if they're right by the gate and the car has stopped, they cannot. So you have to essentially say that it cannot control the entire, under your version, It doesn't control the entire trip in interstate commerce.
This is a facial challenge to the statute. The statute as written, because it is directed at slaughterhouses, is unconstitutional in all of its applications.
If we disagree with that, who wins the case?
If you were to say that the statute has constitutional applications in remote areas, that would be a question of severability. It would probably require a remand or certification to, you know, for determination of whether the applications of the statute...
Where do you find the... Which words are you going to sever and how are you going to redraft the statute? Which section are you actually looking at?
So 599F-A is the one section of the statute that actually mentions something other than slaughterhouses that's before the court here. No slaughterhouse, stockyard, auction, market agency, or dealer shall buy, sell, or receive a non-ambulatory animal. If the term slaughterhouse were simply excised, then the statute would certainly be constitutional because stockyards, auctions, market agencies, and dealers are simply not covered by the Federal Meat Inspection Act, at least these provisions of the Federal Meat Inspection Act.
So in other words, what would happen is that Section A would survive in part and Section B, by your interpretation, which only refers to slaughterhouses, should be completely unconstitutional.
Absolutely. I see I'm out of time. Thank you, Your Honor.
Now you have your rebuttal time. Ms. Sharkey.
Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the court. Preemption at its core is about clashes between the federal interest and the state interest. And I think my adversary here and I agree that the federal interest here is quite narrowly targeted. To come back to Mr. Chief Justice, your point, states have the prerogative to regulate, if they so choose, anything going on with respect to animals on farms and as a general matter. And the federal government has no interest at the present time in doing so. So here we have a federal scheme that actually has two statutes. My colleague didn't precisely differentiate these, but we have the Federal Meat Inspection Act and we have the Humane Methods of Slaughtering Act. Congress, in its usual way, when it enacted the Federal Meat Inspection Act, enacted a preemption provision in one part and a savings clause. We didn't hear anything from my learned colleague about the savings clause, and I will come back to that. This is in the Federal Meat Inspection Act. It then cross-references the Humane Method of Slaughtering Act. The Humane Methods of Slaughtering Act itself has no preemption provision. And in fact, is best.
So you're saying that the only preemption is as to where the purpose is to prevent adulteration rather than protect humane treatment?
Well, Your Honor, I would say that there is ambiguity in terms of a plain text reading because the Humane Methods of Slaughtering Act has no preemption provision, number one.
Well, you said there's an ambiguity. How would you have us resolve it?
My argument would be as follows, that when you look at the preemption provision itself in section 768, the best interpretation of that is that it's targeting animals offered for slaughter, consistent with both Judge Kaczynski's definition below, and it's related because the narrow reading of the express preemption clause is reinforced by the fact that there's one, a savings clause in that very provision. Two, there is a presumption against preemption when we're talking about state regulation of farm animals. And three, to the extent that my colleague is trying to read into the breadth of the scope, the Humane Method of Slaughtering Act's provisions, those are not floors and ceilings. The agency has not so interpreted its regulations, and he's trying to use informal directives that they've passed under that act to have.
Well, you aren't really saying that the state could require a more humane method of slaughtering than the federal statute, are you?
No, Mr. Chief Justice. I am suggesting that all of the provisions. So I will concede the following, unlike some of the parties in the briefs, that the federal scheme for inspection of handling of animals goes beyond merely the interest in adulterated meat. It includes humane handling, but only for animals offered for slaughter.
Inside the house?
Well, I would not put a geographic limitation on it.
So what about the animal in the truck waiting to go in the gate?
No, you cannot. So my argument would be the California law. This is actually interesting. We didn't hear what it's called. It's called the California Downer Animal Protection Act, right? This to me sounds very different from a meat inspection act or a humane slaughtering of animals. Those two are focused on meat and slaughtering. Downer protection The people of California have a moral judgment that any kind of downed animal, they have a moral revulsion to the idea of transforming that animal into meat.
What about the animal that becomes non-ambulatory after it's in the slaughterhouse?
It's the same principle. As long as, it's the idea, for example, if I have a moral revulsion to eating horse meat, mm-hmm. and my state passes, along with me, a ban on that, a horse inadvertently gets to the doors of the slaughterhouse or inside the slaughterhouse, suddenly the state interest, the state power to regulate does not vanish. That's why I would not
put it. It does not vanish. I don't know what the phrase offered for sale means. Suppose it turns out that what we do is we have a long-term sales contract in which a given farm enters into a contract with a common carrier, and the common carrier, in effect, takes these things, buys it from them, and then it agrees to sell them to somebody who's going to buy them from the other end of the slaughterhouse. So they're not only offered for sale, but they're already sold. Now, the question is, under your test, do those animals, given the fact that title is passed to somebody who wishes to use the carcass on the other end, come out from underneath the protection of the California Act?
No, they do not.
Well, and then what does it mean to offer for sale?
Well, I think you can't use, and actually the some of the parties in this case tried to do this kind of gamesmanship to act as if when you get to the door of the slaughterhouse, the title has not transferred, and only after they get inside and potentially are downed, it does, right? So the idea that for here, I think it's very clear.
You and your adversary seem to agree in thinking it's insignificant whether they're inside or outside the door.
I certainly think it's insignificant, yes. And if you look at, the other point I would make about...
So that means, in effect, if they're actually about to be slaughtered, the state could come in and say, no, you've got to euthanize them, and that doesn't interfere with the operations of how the slaughterhouse...
Absolutely. If it were a horse, it would be the same thing. So a category of animal, and I agree, there are certain... I think that a downed animal is a category of animal. California has written this Downer Animal Protection Act to apply not just to slaughterhouses. There was a slight concession that, yes, there's stockyard, auction, market agency, dealer. That's repeated in numerous provisions, not just the first one. And so in other provisions that aren't at issue here, subsection D talks about stockyard, auction, market agency. Subsection E talks about transit, so it's governing when trucking companies, etc. Interestingly, as Mr. Chief Justice suggested earlier, the main target here is obviously farming practices, etc. And the idea is if you have a ban on the receipt.
Well, then your adversary says, so how come it says slaughterhouses all over the statute?
Well, it says slaughterhouses, stockyards, auction, market agency,
which
dealer.
One did it put first?
Slaughterhouse. And in the other provisions,
in subsection
it's the
D,
only one.
Stockyard, but I think the idea is that they're trying to get at the whole chain of distribution. And so, for example, if my adversary concedes that the horse meat cases are decided correctly, it really it mystifies me how you can't have a state an act called the Downer Animal Protection Act that's not classifying
broader
protections.
Suppose we have an Arthritic Animal Protection Act. That okay?
Well, you know, it's interesting. I think that there is, I would be willing to concede, for purposes of my case here, that you would get a worry. I would argue this is going to the implied preemption realm, but there would be a worry with respect to a definition of a category of animal that would potentially significantly interfere with the federal inspection process. Here, the definition of downer animal need not do so.
You know, I have trouble with the section 604, which I think cuts the opposite way. It talks about postmortem examination of carcasses and marking or labeling, destruction of carcasses, condemned reinspection. Now, what I understand is this statute calls for ante-mortem and postmortem inspection. It's obvious that when you're doing the post-mortem inspection, you're not doing it, I think, in these cases, to see whether or not the animals can be slaughtered. Maybe I'm wrong, but maybe not. But one of the clear reasons, I think, why you would want to have a post-mortem inspection is to figure out exactly what the path of the pathogens is and so forth, which are involved in these cases, with an eye to figuring out how you can stop future sorts of adulterations or epidemics going through. If, in fact, you apply the statute as you interpret it, what I come to the conclusion is, if you immediately euthanize and bury them, then, in effect, what you do is you make it impossible with respect to these downer animals to conduct the postmortem inspection. And since that is something which the statute runs, it seems to me that since this postmortem inspection for all these downer animals seems to be important, I would argue that Section 604 is generally drafted, seems to imply that any animal that's in the transportation cycle has to be covered to the federal act, because otherwise I cannot see how it is you can discharge an essential safety function of planning not only individual inspections, but general plans for inspections. So is this argument off base in some way?
Yes, Your Honor, it is. And the reason it's off base is because, while it could in theory suggest that maybe the central purpose here is in some sense making judgments about public spread of various mm-hmm. epidemics and trying to target them. In fact, slaughterhouses today and the Department of Agriculture and its implementing regulations and its directives are clear on this, can make their own decisions not to slaughter animals. And in fact, for the post-mortem inspection concern that the government raises in its brief, it's somewhat specious in a sense because right now, they have a fact sheet that the FSIS distributes that talks about how separate inspection of the non-ambulatory animals is optional, that slaughterhouses may choose to euthanize and discard non-ambulatory animals without this extra inspection.
Let's go back. Justice Scalia, in one of his administrative law opinions, dealing with price controls, I think it was, said that you cannot, as a matter of statutory construction, save a statute which is broader in the way in which it is drafted by showing that the administration in its regulation has decided to construe it more narrowly. So what happens here is if we were to basically get the animal rights people, same folks, going there and saying, we really want to make sure that you inspect these animals in a post-mortem way, whether they die inside the slaughterhouse or en route to the slaughterhouse, I take it that would not be unconstitutional or beyond the scope of Section 604. Is that right?
Yeah, there would be nothing unconstitutional
dormant commerce clause here. So that's not unconstitutional. Right. But then the next question is, would it be beyond the scope of the statutory authorization?
For them to insist that there must be. Well, so the idea here, here's one response though. California could clearly ban the receipt of any of these kind of animals. So you're only talking about one that gets through this sieve mistakenly.
No, I don't concede, at least for the purpose of the discussion, that they could ban the receipt. I mean, I think the position that I'm taking is that once the animals enter into transportation after they've left the farm, that what happens is it's a comprehensive scope of federal regulation. And in this particular situation, I do not think that the way this comprehensive system works or its scope depends upon a narrowing interpretation or the denial of a narrowing interpretation by the administrative state.
So but there's nothing, Your Honor, if I may interrupt you. It's unusual, but in your instance, I feel the need, given my time.
Your time is drawing nigh.
In this instance, there is nothing whatsoever in this narrowly targeted entire scheme of either the Federal Meat Inspection Act or the Humane Methods of Slaughtering Act that suggests that any category of animal must be presented for slaughter. So you tried to change this to once it's in transport.
Take the question to be, if the statute requires post-mortem inspections, to do post-mortem inspections have apparently some kind of public health benefit that is important to the agency. Therefore, there's a public interest in making sure dead animals get to the post-mortem inspection stage. Do you see any flaw in that argument?
Well, I still think the state could ban a category of animals mm-hmm. from even entering into transportation.
You said the same argument could be made about horses. I mean, they want to check horse disease, so they need as many dead horses as possible in the slaughterhouse.
No, exactly. See, the point about it is that you and Judge Kaczynski make the argument that when you use the phrase type of animal, you can extend it from horses to ambulatory animals.
Absolutely.
My view is you cannot do that if this provision is there, because the horse-only category does not implicate post-mortem inspections, because these are all, or many of them, healthy horses, whereas the moment you define the species to be a downer species, well, those are exactly the kind of animals. So if you read 604, the clear implication from it is that the type of animals has to be by species. It can be females, it can be males, but the one classification that is inconsistent with 604 is that which turns on the health status of the animal.
But I disagree that we can necessarily infer that the only reason to ban horses is unconnected to any kind of worry about disease, because the worry was about the treatment of those horses and what was happening after the fact, right? Similarly, with respect to downer animals, the science, in fact, there's a big worry about downer cows. You don't want to look at what the agency's done, but as the, Mr. Chief Justice reminded us earlier in the argument, the agency has actually said that the non-ambulatory cattle must be immediately euthanized. They're pending, there's pending rulemaking where they're trying to decide to extend this to veals, to all animals, et cetera. So the main point is, under your scheme, if a state just has a moral interest in banning, if the idea, for example, of eating a pregnant pig, if the idea of eating a nursing pig, if the idea of eating a baby pig, if the idea of eating a horse revolts me and my fellow citizens, we can ban that, irrespective if there's a health interest. And unless the federal scheme could correctly be read to say there is such a strong safety interest in tainted meat or the spread
but the idea of eating a sick pig could be revolting too. But nevertheless, you would not say that that California can make its own rules for when slaughterhouses can take sick pigs or when a pig is too sick.
Absolutely. And I think the main point, just if I could get back to a point of statutory interpretation, because clearly we wouldn't take Section 604 and put it on steroids and not look at the rest of the federal statute.
No, we're not putting it on steroids.
Well, I think it's very clear when you look at the Federal Meat Inspection Act, when you look at the narrowness of the preemption provision, as I mentioned, I'd like to at least mention the fact, since my adversary didn't even mention the fact, that this provision has various limitations in the terms, right? It's within the scope of this chapter with respect to premises, facilities, operations. He did get that far. But it then includes a savings clause that says this chapter shall not preclude any state from making requirements or taking other action with respect to any other matters regulating under this chapter. This act, properly read, is a very narrow federal interest.
Any other matter, I think, if I had to reconcile these two things, it would say that any other matter has to do with humane issues. So, for example, there's a huge part of the brief which was prepared in this case, which explained in exquisite detail why it is that the conditions under which these pigs were raised, where they could not turn around, where their bodies were made too big for their legs and all the other stuff, was simply desperate. But the way I would read this statute is that the states themselves could do this. California, I dare say, let me see if I'm right, could not say that you could not ship in interstate commerce into California a pig that violated its standards for fair handling if the pig was in fact handled in Iowa. That's correct.
Handled
in Iowa, in another state. That it would be up for Iowa to decide how its pigs are going to be handled during the state.
Yes.
So what seems to me is that this brief actually cuts exactly in the opposite direction from what it's intended, because what it does is it identifies a huge class of cases which are outside the particular statute, but it doesn't touch the post-mortem administration when it's known that there's a risk that an animal is dangerous. And if the animal dies in transit, right, I think there's at least a presumption that there's a high enough probability that it's going to be a sick or infected cow or pig in some sense that it ought to be there. So I think if you have 604, you can save everything else that you want to talk about. But I don't see how you can treat as a class of animals animals that are downer, when in fact that's the very class of animals that this particular statute is designed to glom onto.
Well, I disagree entirely with that this is the very class of animals that's targeted. I don't know where you're reading that from the statutory language. And if you have ambiguities in the statutory language, you do several things. You, one, think about the presumption against preemption, which we haven't talked about yet. And I know you might have an aversion to that canon of an interpretation. Secondly, even if you don't go to the presumption against preemption, you look at actually the regulations as passed by the agency that's been delegated authority. And they have made a sharp distinction between cattle and pigs, and they would sharply disagree that 604 is designed specifically to make sure that downer animals, namely downer pigs, have post-mortem inspections. In fact, they specifically do not require federally inspected slaughterhouses to do that. They give them an option to immediately euthanize.
But that goes back to the question as to whether or not you narrow the scope of a statute in terms of its preemptive reach by showing the way in which the regulations are interpreted. And I think it's going to be, this is a facial challenge.
I understand that, but where's your argument in the statutory language? One could argue that the whole scope of the Federal Meat Inspection Act.
Could somebody, just for my edification, explain which part of the statute you people are talking about? Where does it say?
We're talking about Section 604, postmortem examination of carcasses.
Where does it say down?
It says nothing about downer animals. That was the point, Your Honor, that I was trying to make.
Just asking.
And in fact, my read of the Federal Meat Inspection Act is that it's only, all of these provisions come into play when animals are offered for slaughter, and that this category of downer animal would never be offered to slaughter. And there's absolutely nothing inconsistent with the idea of post-mortem inspection for animals that have been offered for slaughter.
Let me again, that seems to be wrong on the record, because when they talk about pigs, they talk about two kinds of downer pigs. They talk about those which are downer because of fatigue, which a little bit of rest and rehabilitation then make them permissible for sale. And then there are others which turn out to be diseased. And the whole point of this thing is essentially to say that we need at least the anti-mortem inspection to figure out which are which. If, in fact, you have an anti-mortem inspection that lets some of them go through, and some of them may not go through and they die, it seems to me that the whole purpose of the inspection of a dead animal includes, at the very least, the health side of this stuff, so that what they've done under the federal statute is they're taking all these downer animals out for special treatment. They're trying to figure out which one should be treated which way, so that it's a fundamentally different kind of category from every other category that was mentioned by Judge Kaczynski. That seems to me to be correct, and I'm still not persuaded that it's wrong. I mean, it may be wrong, but I think the fact that they don't mention why they're inspecting them is not particularly important, because why on earth would you otherwise run a meat inspection statute if health was not at least one of the issues?
Well, there's nothing, I do think it's critical that there's nothing in the Federal Meat Inspection Act that demands or requires the slaughter of any animals.
But that's clear.
So you're trying to read that into the statute
through this provision,
and I think it's an incorrect statutory interpretation.
Is it plausible to you to think that it is part of the statutory purpose to get more sick animals for postmortem inspection so that we have more information about the health of the animal?
I do not think, no, that that's the purpose of the Federal Meat Inspection Act, no, Your Honor.
Well, is it one collateral purpose?
It's an incidental benefit, I'll give you that. But then we're into the realm of, it seems absurd to me, especially in a provision that directly references the secretary and what the secretary has discretion to do, to say that we're going to then be blind to how the secretary has interpreted this. And to me, it seems quite decisive that even if it's this incidental benefit that even the government and the secretary don't embrace as a central purpose.
But if they change their mind, would it be unconstitutional? Would it be beyond their statutory authority?
If Congress rewrote this statute
to say that
animals must be brought in for slaughter,
suppose the department issues a regulation that said that.
And it's Chevron deference world.
Yeah, well, so it's a subject near and dear to my heart that we've to now kind of avoid it. In this instance, the agency has actually passed some directives, as my colleague suggested, without notice and comment. They have relied in their brief on certain documents that are basically just internal practices about what they tell to their employees, et cetera. So I don't think that should get Chevron or any kind of deference. I do think it's a difficult call in this instance, if there were, but this is definitely hypothetical, if the agency passed under the Humane Methods of Slaughtering Act a regulation that they intended to have preemptive effect, when the statute itself has no preemption provision, I would think that courts would have to interrogate with a lot of scrutiny their arguments. And so, for example, if they are just based on, if they haven't entertained the moral considerations raised by the state, they'd have to say what's justifying it. If it were a real health and safety risk, then I would be willing to give it some deference. But we're not at that stage.
Let me change the subject slightly. Suppose we were to disagree with both you and your adversary and say this statute, the California statute, or what's left of it after the Ninth Circuit got through with it, is half good and half bad, and that the borderline is the door of the slaughterhouse. The state can't reach inside the door, but it can do anything it wants outside the door. If that is our view, what do we do? Who wins this case? Well, your answer is I win the case, but tell me why.
I certainly win the case, and I think that I'm trying to think of what would be, I mean, the vast majority, so the ban on the receipt provision, would stand the ban on the sale of meat products. I suppose we would be talking about a small category of cases that
what is the law generally? If there's a facial challenge to a statute and the statute is constitutional in some but not all of its applications, what happens?
You know, it appears that Judge Kaczynski was convinced, and the parties didn't contest that this was fully severable. Nobody's contested that.
This is one of these sort of odd arguments, but is there anything which leads you to reject the compromise position that Mr. Hills put forward, I guess is the question that's being asked? Because he said...
Absolutely. When you tried to present this compromise about barring the state at the door, the reason I think that doesn't make sense is that we allow for state regulation inside the facilities in a whole host of realms, right? We allow for provisions about worker safety. We allow for provisions actually about animal cruelty, so long as the provision on animal cruelty would be something that would be prosecutable under the federal standard, that's okay. So it would be bizarre to bar the state interest in protecting against a moral revulsion about a category of animal at the door. So I would implore you not to do so, because that makes no sense. And I would, if you, as my adversary concedes, if you think that the horse cases are rightly decided, I would try to imagine the kind of situation if the horse gets inside mistakenly. Does it mean then that they can go forward and slaughter it and sell it and everything's okay? That would be bizarre. So it seems bizarre to have a geographical limitation. Either the state has an interest or not.
So in other words, if we decide, in effect, that downer animals are not a species, then you lose from one end of the situation to the other. If we decide that downer animals should be treated as a separate type, even though not a species, then you think you sweep the boards and the entire statute goes.
Well, I like sweeping the boards. I like the latter. Yeah, I don't think you have to decide that downers aren't a species, right? I think what you have to decide is what is the federal interest at stake here and what is the state interest at stake here. And if the federal interest is targeted at animals offered for slaughter, then there's a wide berth for states to define protections based on moral or other
considerations. There's also another way you could read the statute, which is that this is sort of hinted at, is that it is an interest of the federal government to see that all animals which are in fact not diseased can be shipped into interstate commerce. And if, in fact, you apply this particular statute...
Your Honor, I must interrupt you again.
No,
because there's absolutely
no,
there's...
No, please.
No, you don't interrupt. What happens is there is at least some sense that what you're trying to do in these cases is to reduce two kinds of error. One of them is slaughtering animals that ought to be shipped, and those which are shipping animals that ought to be slaughtered. And the question is, can one read this statute as having as a subsidiary but legitimate purpose, trying to make sure that animals that are fit for slaughter under the federal standards are not going to be kept out of the slaughtering house for sale by the state standards?
Right. I think absolutely not. I think you cannot read the Federal Meat Inspection Act to have a purpose to maximize meat production in the country. There's absolutely no way. No one has asserted that. It would be absurd.
What do you take to be the purpose of the preemption clause?
I take the purpose of the preemption clause to suggest that animals that have been offered for slaughter will have to be processed exclusively by the federal requirements.
In other words, so that the slaughter, the guy who owns the slaughterhouse, only has to look up one set of regulations.
Meaning, I'm not sure what you mean by that.
That is, no matter where the slaughterhouse is located, if, in fact, you're talking about slaughtering rules, you look at the federal rules, you need not look at anything else.
Right. Yeah. Yes, absolutely. I'm sorry, I thought you were then getting between the Humane Slaughtering Act and the Federal Meat Inspection Act. Absolutely, right. And I think that makes perfect sense. And I think stepping back and just thinking writ large about core interest in preemption, here we have a vast area of state regulation of animals. We have a federal interest that is not one of maximizing meat production, is not about moral regulation, is about...
I'm sorry to be obsessed with geography, which both you and Mr. Hill seem to think is ridiculous, but once the pig is inside the slaughterhouse, can't you see a significant administrative problem for the guy in charge of running the slaughterhouse, who has to worry about the federal rules on downer pigs and the state rules on downer pigs.
Then we're in the realm of thinking about if there's implied obstacle preemption. And at that point, I think we're not looking. We're trying to figure out, is there something?
We're trying to interpret, and there clearly is an express preemption. We're trying to define its scope. In defining its scope, shouldn't we consider when it does give the protection that is appropriate to the regulated industry?
I think you can. I think particularly, so here we have a situation where we have an express preemption provision, a savings clause against the backdrop of the presumption against preemption in a massive area that's been the purview of state regulation for hundreds of years. In that scenario, I think that you can, on the plain language of this, the best read of it is to think of it as narrowly targeted to animals offered up for slaughter at these federally regulated institutions. If, however, there were a strong argument, and here there is nothing to support such an empirical factual record that I think there would need to be, if there were a strong argument that nonetheless the state law was obstructing the purpose of the federal mandated inspection schemes for animals offered for target, I would be willing to entertain an argument of obstacle preemption.
Now we've had other cases like the cigarette preemption statutes, where in fact both safety and uniformity into interstate commerce have both been there. So again, it's the same kind of question that when asked before. Suppose when you look at this particular statute, the secretary in charge of it said, you know, we've listened to the meat people. They said that too many animals that should be shipped are going to be killed. And so therefore, we are now upset with the change in regulations that essentially decided that there was a legitimate purpose in facilitating sales of healthy animals into interstate commerce, in fact, reverse the argument that you've made.
Right. So, Your Honor, I'm out of time. Let me just have 30 seconds.
Yeah.
So it's a very intriguing question. In fact, it's one we will presumably face because there are such pending regulations. Here I would just refer you to in Williamson versus Mazda, Justice Breyer, in talking about the kinds of arguments or interests that we look to the agency, specifically mentioned cost effectiveness. So the idea would be it would be akin to the Department of Agriculture saying this is too costly on the meat industry and it's going to be too expensive. He said we should be at least, he wasn't crystal clear, but he said we should be reticent about reading those cost effectiveness when the purpose of the statute is safety, et cetera. So here I would just go back to the purpose of the Federal Meat Inspection Act, the core purpose about protecting against adulterated meat, et cetera.
Even though you're out of time, there's a question that's been bothering me. You keep talking about the presumption against preemption. Are we doomed to apply the presumption against preemption even when we're interpreting a statute? There are those who have suggested persuasively that when there's an express preemption, we're supposed to figure out what Congress wanted to do and not presume anything.
Right. So I think in the first instance, you can look, and I would argue that you can resolve this case in my way by the best read of the statutory language. If, however, you think that there are two alternative reads, then I think you must, at this stage, unless you can convince one more of your brethren to come along with you, you will be applying the presumption against preemption.
In other words, we would have to, there's a case, and you'll probably tell me what it is, that says I'm stuck with that.
Yeah, so the most recent non-plurality opinion from the U.S. Supreme Court, Wyeth versus Levine, says it applies in all cases. In Medtronic versus Lohr, which is an express preemption case.
Okay, I was afraid of that. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Mr. Hill? Oh, I'm not.
Thank you, Mr. Chief Justice. Two quick points, the most important of which is there's only one act referenced in the preemption clause. The Act. In fact, in a codified version of the statute, it says the chapter. That encompasses both the humane provisions of the statute and the sanitary provisions. There is no textual basis for distinguishing between them. The fact that the Humane Methods of Slaughter Act was amending the Federal Meat Inspection Act in 1978 is highlighting simply the fact that it is part of the Federal Meat Inspection Act and was so characterized in the statute at large as an amendment. And so my esteemed colleague, the Respondents' Counsel, when she says that somehow the preemptive force of the humanitarian regulations is less than the preemptive force of the sanitary regulations, or different in any way, confuses me, because I think that's plainly in tension with the text of 678. The second point, and the most critical point, is that there is a federal rule addressing pain from the handling of non-ambulatory animals. There is no federal rule addressing ethical concerns associated with the killing of intelligent animals, companionate animals, or animals because of characteristics unrelated
to health. And could there be under this statute such a rule?
If you were to construe humane methods of handling to include trauma especially associated with some species, perhaps, but it would stretch the very boundaries of the act. Because remember, the only humanitarian concerns in the act are those concerned with methods of handling. The federal rules specifically...
Methods of handling by a slaughterhouse.
Pardon me?
Methods of handling animals by a slaughterhouse.
Yes, exactly.
I mean, what I keep coming back to is I get the impression that the problem that California is concerned with is a handling of pigs by pigs that have never been in a slaughterhouse.
To quote the respondent's brief at page 40, the purpose of preventing the purpose of the statute is to prevent animals from, quote, enduring great pain during the slaughter process. The thing that inspired the act was a videotape of a slaughterhouse. The only focus of the statute ever from 1993...
Well, but even that is a little different from pain induced by the handling in the slaughterhouse. I mean, what they're saying is that if an animal's already feeling poorly when it gets in there, it's going to endure great pain during the slaughtering process, and therefore we're going to keep it out.
I would differ, Your Honor. I think that the plain mischief addressed by the statute is pain associated with being non-ambulatory, and it's purely pain associated with moving.
But isn't it, in some sense, it's pain doing slaughter under those circumstances, and the way in which they try to avoid this problem is to keep you out of the slaughterhouse and to slaughter it by some other technique, and to euthanize it and to prevent the dragging and so forth. And none of those things involve the operations of a slaughterhouse, which is the key term in which the preemption seems to be
It's one key term. There's at least three points you need to have with preemption, in addition to being in addition to, and that's clearly met here. I think everybody concedes that these humanitarian regulations are in addition to the regulations of non-ambulatory animals. Mm. You need to have a state purpose which is focused upon pain or humanitarian concerns associated with a method of handling. I submit that the only conceivable ethical concern you'd have with non-ambulatory animals in particular, the thing that makes non-ambulatoriness special, is it's associated with pain from movement. And indeed, everything we know about this California statute suggested they were only concerned with pain from movement. There's a second requirement for preemption that must be met. You must be, the state law must be with respect to operations. And so if the state law is not with respect to operations, even if it's trying to mitigate pain from movement, it's not preempted. Both concerns, however, are met when animals are lined up outside the slaughterhouse, because then those animals are within the operations of the slaughterhouse. And both of them are met when the state law is associated with an ailment, the legal relevance of which, or the moral relevance of which, is solely associated with pain from handling.
So you keep talking about the animals that are lined up outside the slaughter. Let's suppose a phone call between the stockyard and the slaughterhouse. Mm-hmm. The stockyard guy says, "We got a lot of pigs here. Some of them are non-ambulatory." The slaughterhouse guy says, "I don't worry about that. Bring them on over." Mm-hmm. Can the state of California make that illegal?
Certainly, it can make it illegal for the stockyard to deliver them, and certainly,
but not for the slaughterhouse to take them.
If the non-ambulatory standards go beyond the federal humane standards, I would think it would be very difficult to say that regulating the phone calls emanating from within a slaughterhouse, from a slaughterhouse facility that comply with federal standards, is not exclusively covered under the federal statute.
Can I ask you one simple question? I asked your opponent counsel about the post-mortem examination.
Oh,
you have not come one way or another. Do you think that this is a diversion, or do you think that it helps?
Unfortunately, I'm out of time, Your Honor.
Well, you can answer this question.
Please ask the question.
I would say that certainly another purpose of the statute is to sequester, to separate sick animals to prevent infection. And indeed, there are several rules passed by the Secretary that require the slaughterhouse to notify when an animal is discovered to be non-ambulatory, to require the animal to be set aside when it's non-ambulatory, and to be inspected both ante and post-mortem.
No, the question is, could they order these inspections of animals that are en route to the slaughterhouse but not in the vicinity thereof?
Could the Secretary pass a rule addressing that issue?
That's the question.
Certainly it's plausible under Section 603A, because clearly that is relevant to and the protection of sanitary quality. I would say, however, that the humanitarian reach, if you read the text of 603B, it goes far beyond 603A. In that 603A, which deals with the sanitary considerations, refers specifically to the territory of the slaughterhouse, within the slaughterhouse, where 603B says any handling in connection with slaughter.
Do you argue that there is a federal interest that is reflected in the requirement for post-mortem inspections, that there's essentially a federal interest in maximizing the number of sick animals that get in there so they'll be able to detect more disease?
There's certainly a federal interest in making sure that if an animal is suspected in being sick, it's isolated as soon as possible. And
that wasn't my question.
Yeah, I would not argue that there's a federal interest in maximizing meat production, but there's certainly a federal interest.
No, that wasn't quite my question either. Is there the post-mortem inspection, presumably when you're inspecting an animal that's already dead, you're not worrying about the animal's health. You're worrying about whether you can detect something in that animal that will alert you to some problem that can help you protect the public from other animals. Does that suggest to you an argument that the federal interest is infringed when sick animals are kept out of the slaughterhouse? The federal government is losing the opportunity to gather this information?
That there could be such a federal interest is possible. That the statute protects such a federal interest, I think, is remote, given that the sanitary statutory provisions and the rules are so closely tied with only the animals that are in line to go into the slaughterhouse. Thank you.
Now, what are we supposed to think about this case?
We're having a private conversation.
Yes, we're having a private
conversation. Yeah, what's wrong with different from?
Oh, no, they had different than is the language in the statute.
Right,
so
right.
The one thing about the statute is ungrammatical, but that's the only thing that I can correct in this particular case.
Oh, okay, all right.
Yeah, I mean, look, what is the class of animals, I think, is the key question. I've always inclined that the district court judge got it right on that particular point. I think that it's the...
You're to reverse.
I think at this particular point, I mean, whenever I read a clever Kaczynski opinion, it always seems to set me off in the opposite direction.
That's a good argument. I see.
He talks about the delicate moral judgments and so forth. My view about
also
it...
Also had bad jokes about horses and hogs.
We don't mind that. It's just that... The problem that I have in this particular case, I think, is that health is paramount. I think that health and safety has always been done in tension with sales and distribution. So if you get too much health stuff, you get too much sent through there. My own view is that I think if they wanted to assert this particular control, I would put the demarcation point as between the time at which the animals enter into the stream of commerce, so that it's clearly federal, as opposed to being on the farm. And the battle is whether or not it's there or at the time that it arrives at the stockhouse when it's clearly specific. And there's nothing about anything that anybody said on either side that made it clear to me which way it goes. So, I mean, I'm genuinely at a puzzle on this thing. I don't find much help from the presumption against preemption. I do in cases, well, I have to now, in cases like Wyeth and Levine, because those are private right of action.
You don't have
cases.
To anymore. You're on the Supreme Court. You can.
No. I am bound by my retired colleagues, not by their extrajudicial writings, but by the Supreme Court. But let's suppose that Wyeth is good law. I think there's been a radically different tradition between the preemption of private rights of action on the one hand and state administrative schemes on the other, and there's much less deference to the state administrative schemes than there is with respect to the private rights of action. Because the danger of inconsistent overlay by administrative directives is much greater.
Well, so you're saying the presumption against preemption is stronger in the case of the administrative scheme.
The presumption in favor of
it's weaker
because I think the interference issue is much stronger. I think the uniformity issue turns out to be much stronger, and so the question is, singling these animals out on the basis of their healthcare condition. If I understand Professor Sharkey's argument is that even if one of them slipped by the gate and got into the factory, there would be is state preemption on that.
Well, I mean, I must have too simple a mind because
you think of the line.
You figured out what I was thinking. Yeah, my question's the way of doing that.
Yeah, for a gun I like that position.
If it's in the slaughterhouse, it's preempted. If it's not in the slaughterhouse, it's not preempted. What are you guys bothering me for?
Well, I mean, the problem about that is, well, it seems to me that if you do that, it's giving essentially the interest of the meat companies in having an orderly, comprehensive scheme is going to be effectively stopped, because in each and every case, there's a kind of going to be an administrative procedure that you could put together. So, for example, at 10 miles from the thing, the state stops every train going into the slaughterhouse and says, we'd like to inspect. And I don't see any objection to it. Yet at the moment you start putting this second
They can certainly do that and say, I want to see there are no horses in here.
I agree with that. But in this particular case, I think that you could do the horses by the manifest. And as you said before, you know, it's not real difficult inspection.
It's not all that simple. Because I agree with you that they can't stop the train mm-hmm. and say, I want to see if there are any sick pigs in here.
Yes.
Because that's because the sick slaughtering sick pig problem is a federal problem.
Yes.
I guess I have the sense that there is some, although it's tricky, there is a somewhat larger state interest, or at least and more federal deference to the state interest in the humanitarian side of it. Maybe because uniformity doesn't seem so obviously important.
It's also very complicated, because I take it, could the state impose regulations on the way in which the animals are, in fact, housed when they're on the trains that are going in interstate commerce?
Sure. Interstate commerce? Well, yeah, we aren't doing interstate commerce.
The statute
doesn't preempt it.
The point is that that question then gets into the dormant commerce clause, which is always lurking around the edges.
Let it lurk. It's not in this case.
Well, it is in this case if you decide that they can inspect them at the state border when they come in to see whether or not they're in a disease.
Maybe they can't, but nothing in the Federal Meat Inspection Act says they
can't. Well, no. But the point is, if you discover the burden, and this looks like Southern Pacific against Arizona, where you're requiring things that are neutral on their face, but they're a burden on interstate commerce. So it seems to me that, you know, that the inspection stuff is troublesome, because what you're doing is you're now saying that you can tell people how they carry things on the train. I think that that would be subject to an implied preemption / dormant commerce clause argument, or at least I'm not sure that it would be done so. And so what I do is, you know, if I hear you say we want bright line rules, and then I hear you say this is a tricky question, tricky questions don't arise with bright line rules. So the bright line rule that gets rid of the overlap is the one that says once they're on the train, they're out from underneath the state regulation, rather than the one that says once they get towards the slaughterhouse, and then you have to figure out to get back. Now, I don't know whether that's a winning argument. And I'm still not sure whether my preemption argument based on the postmortem stuff is right, because I don't like reading statutes in the sense that the scope of the statute is now determined by the way in which it's interpreted. And so if I thought that it was perfectly ambiguous that the postmortem stuff would apply to the pre-entry into the slaughterhouse determinations, I would say it's preempted. But, you know, this is one of these topsy-turvy arguments, because Mr. Hill's kind of conceded that, you know, I don't think you go that far.
Maybe I'm misunderstanding you, but I don't think there's any federal interest in getting sick pigs into slaughterhouses. I just don't buy it.
Not getting into slaughterhouses, finding out what's wrong with them so that the stuff that does get into slaughterhouses.
I understand that there could be an advantage in having more sick pigs in slaughterhouses because you'll learn more about the disease, but I just don't really believe that's what the federal government's trying to do.
Well, they're not trying to do it administratively. The question is whether or not if they decided to do this. I mean, because you could easily imagine.
There's no ifs in this case. This is a case of what the federal government has legislated.
No, it's not what they has legislated. It's what it also has regulated under the regulation. So now let's suppose we reverse this case, just thinking out loud. And what happens is the Humane Society, having lost this case, now goes back to the federal government and says, what we want you to do is to step up the inspections that you have on the trains going into the slaughterhouses. Would that be an illegitimate move, and the secretary would be forced to turn it down? And I don't know what the answer to that question is.
The
Humane Society. They go and we
affirm here.
No, what we do is we reverse.
We say it's preempted.
We preempt. And now, of course, what you do is nobody ever stops, right? an interest group will, it's like a plant going to life, they'll always revise. So what they do is they go and they appear before the Secretary of Agriculture and the appropriate person and said, look, we know this is preempted.
So you preempted us, so start regulating.
Yeah, start regulating and regulate in this particular fashion. Would that be something which you say, no, you couldn't regulate that stuff because it's on a train and it's not at the gate? I think that would probably go out the other way.
I don't know what you mean by the other way, but yeah, they could regulate.
So then you get to the Scalia decision that if, you know, when you have a massive price control statute which is void because of vagueness and the administrator tries to cure it by giving more specific rules, we are now told very clearly as a matter of public administrative law, you cannot save a vague statute by a specific regulation.
Who's talking about vague statutes?
Well, you are talking about one which is uncertain as to its scope, as to whether it goes only to the plant door or beyond.
You're talking about the federal statute.
Yeah, federal statute. And you can't save its, as it were, the state statute from preemption if the federal government could, in fact, do the broader reading on the grounds that it has not done it. That's what I think the hard principle is. So, I mean, I think that it's a very close case.
I admit it's a close case, but I would rather, I'm inclined, I'm inclined just to affirm, and maybe I'm crazy, but I thought the rule was that if you've got a facial attack on a statute, and you take a look at it and you say it's valid as applied to 38 cases and invalid as applied to the other 22, you dismiss the facial challenge and you say you've got an as applied challenge and go sue.
No, because I don't think that this is a question of scope and competence. And if in fact what you want to say is that this is something which is within the scope of the statute, that is, it falls within the operations and so forth, then in effect what happens is the statute now becomes clear. And if the statute becomes clear, then it becomes amenable to a state challenge. And I have to say, I think that when you want to determine type, Kaczynski did not persuade me when he started to talk about moral and delicate judgments about various kinds of subclasses, because the only class that I care about being preempted is those which have to do with the inherent operation of the inspection process. And I think that's the one class that you cannot put and lump together with the other.
I know whether they're saying the same thing or not, but I agree it's a close case because this is sort of if it's a pure pure ethical problem, like we don't shoot, we don't kill horses, that's an easy case. And if it's a pure health problem, like we're going to inspect for mad cow disease, that's easy the other way. Yeah. I'm not quite sure whether a non-ambulatory pig is more like a mad cow or a horse.
I think it's more like a mad cow. And let me put it this way. Normally in these cases, there's at least a view which says that when the federal government weighs in on how it wants this to go, you ought to take that into account. And this is a case in which the federal government asserted the interest in preemption in what was a pretty strong brief, as far as I'm concerned. And so the question here is, do we apply the presumption against preemption and decide with Judge Sharkey, she acted like a judge, but Lawyer Sharkey, Lawyer Sharkey, or whether or not we apply the basic notion of deference to the federal government and its operations of its plan. And my inclination on this particular case is if the federal government and its operations thinks that it's a broader situation, in a case that's this close where I think that it could pass regulations that would clearly oust the California statute, my inclination would be to essentially find it preempted.
Of course, I've never heard of the federal government before. I mean, this is the first time I know. I've heard a rumor about something called Chevron deference. I have not the slightest idea what Skidmore deference is.
Skidmore deference is, sir, it's that we've got something which is entitled to respect but not deference because it wasn't passed with notice and comment rules, as Mr. Hill sort of mentioned.
So the federal government gets respect but not deference.
Yes, and in a case where it's very close, it takes very little to tip the balance. So instead of needing deference, I think what you need under this surface is sort of respect. I think the Supreme Court took this.
Isn't some respect due for the sovereignty of the states of the United States?
Only in the eyes of New York Court of Appeal judges, I think. I let me just, as a predictive matter, having said this aloud, I actually think the government weighing in this particular fashion will turn out to be the dispositive factor, because I think the structure of the statute is close enough to be to either menu. But what's interesting is when I listen
to
this.
So you're predicting that the court
appeals
will reverse.
And not only that, and I also think that it's right. I think in these cases that given the fact that we've exhausted all the other arguments, on direct interpretation that the administrative nod as to what they think the scope of their authority is what matters, rather than the particular exercise of that particular authority.
All right. Well, I think at this point the judgment below is affirmed by an equally divided court.
I think here that's probably right, which is why we hope that nobody has to recuse themselves. I think actually this one could go 9-0 in the Supreme Court, with everybody thinking it close, but all thinking the same way, because I don't see any political interest. But I would think, my guess is it will be affirmed. I would affirm it, and I would go to bed feeling very uneasy about the decision. Would you feel uneasy about your vote, or are you just more confident because you do this more often?
No, I feel more uneasy than I would about some. This is not, it's not by any means the clearest case I've ever seen. My sense of it is, I'm not so sure that you're going to see the Justice Sotomayor's of the world vote against animals. I think there is a political overtone here that may have its effect.
I actually thought they overplayed the animal card in the brief, and I commend Lawyer Sharkey for not pushing that line of argument there.
You have to know your bench.
I think with respect to the Supreme Court, interestingly enough, I actually litigated one of these cases where they tried to ban the sale of whatever it was, some kind of animal, duck pate, because of the way in which the inhumane treatment of the animal in the town in which it was slaughtered. This was a real case in Illinois. And I think we would have won on the grounds that the state of Illinois cannot take into account the conditions of slaughter that are located elsewhere inside the system. But before we can do this, two things happen. One, it was absolutely widespread defiance of the rule on the part of all the named restaurants in Chicago, and then the statute was repealed. I think that it's a real mistake to push this case on the state police power issue with respect to farms, given the fact that there's no competing interest on the other side.
Should we let these people ask some questions?
Oh, the audience, absolutely, yes. Yeah. Somebody has to have a question.
Or abusive comments are also.
Yeah. You can interrupt us. Oh, you got somebody. Once you break the ice, there'll be 50 questions.
This is loud. The distinction between health concerns and moral concerns or consumer preference concerns to be really very interesting and nuanced. Would that not potentially weigh in favor of avoiding preemption so that a state's citizenry can decide what is health to them and what is moral revulsion, per se? Like, the difference, if you have a clear standard that it cuts across all, that you must wash the meat in some kind of chlorine in order to disinfect, versus a state populace that is particularly progressive that would prefer that the animal was slaughtered outdoors, where it's very different. I mean, you have flies coming and things. You have other health concerns, but you don't have bleach in your food. Is the nuance in health and preference?
I think indignation gets you to horses versus non-horses.
It doesn't get you to...
But the problem is, I think this comes within the core concerns of health versus non-health, which is clearly a topic which is designed for federal regulation. And I think that's why they intervene. I don't believe the federal government, intervened in any of the horse cases. I don't think they care about all that stuff, but I do think they care about this. I actually think that the federal government, in its brief, did raise the post-mortem inspection point on the first page. Which again, if I'm sitting there on the Supreme Court wondering whether or not this is not an interest, they're telling me that it is. And suppose they had some pending regulations on this, which I don't know if they do, but if they did, I think that would end the case. The pending regulations, do you agree with that?
I don't think so.
Woo, tough man.
Although I'm not, maybe it's because I'm not as attuned to the this the deference to the king's will that seems to be so does seem to have a large part in federal jurisprudence. I'm sort of used to making up my mind what I think.
Yeah,
is
I know.
Right and
I mean, there is a case called Spritzma, which was cited in one of the briefs, which is a case which I find the behavior just appalling by everybody, in which when the case got to the Supreme Court, people lobbied the Solicitor General's office and got them to give an interpretation of a statute or a report which could have easily been read the other way. And Justice Stevens, writing for the court, basically gave that dispositive weight, if I'm not mistaken. So my view is, if you now have a government kind of coming in on one of these things where it's close, and you don't have any of this kind of intrigue, as you did in that was a private right of action case, I think it's going to be very, very heavy. So in terms of prediction, I think that the fact that the government filed the brief is decisive, notwithstanding the fact that you may not even bother to read. That's the way I think it would come out. And I think in this particular area, to answer your other question again, is the problem with the Democratic argument is which democracy? The federal one or the state one? And, you know, you're talking about health and safety, so even I don't have a strong Lochnerite view saying the whole meat statute is unconstitutional. You're not going to get that out of anybody on anywhere. And at that point, I think the deference arguments or the so forth will win. I mean, in fact, I think my own sense is I think that Rick
I guess I'm having trouble with the federal. And I mean I agree the government's brief was a good brief, but when the strength of the brief was it kept quoting the statute and jumping up and down on the words. When it got to what the federal interest was, I did not find it convincing.
Well, I mean this is a situation where you. If you're reading the argument for the merits, one can make it one way or another. I think, Kathy Sharkey said had a lot of power to it. She said, they're worried about slaughterhouse operations. They're not worried about these animals that are going to be buried down the road a long time away. And I think that's certainly the focus of the thing. But I think if the federal government says, this is an age of expanding regulatory expertise and we can do this by administrative deference, the federal tradition, more than the state tradition, is hugely deferential on things, even I might add, if you think they're jurisdiction, which I regard as wrong. But I think that they regard it as right. So, I mean, it is a very different tradition. My guess is under New York state law that you couldn't have the preemption issue, but you would not have the same level of deference that you had. Because remember one of these crazy housing cases that your court decided?
Yeah, the one that you attack in your
yes.
forthcoming book. Yeah, yeah.
And rightly
yeah,
so.
An opinion which I joined and which was right.
Yeah. Yeah. It's opinion of this, which I thought was dreadful, but or wrong or something like
yeah,
that.
Well,
but
it was
a case in which you had the administrator coming out basically supporting the industry, and the court overturned it mm-hmm. on statutory grounds. Mm-hmm. I mean, that doesn't happen, I think, at the federal level. I mean,
it's nice to know that federal regulators are all powerful, and that you seem to be in favor of that.
No. I'm in favor of them only on the preemption kind of issue. And of course, I also take very different attitude on rate regulation stuff because I would have struck down the whole scheme on constitutional grounds on that one, rent control statute.
Oh yeah, okay.
But I don't have that instinct.
I see that point, but that may be a bit of a reach.
I think, given the state of the law in New York State, trying to challenge rent control on constitutional grounds today, you might as well just put your head into one of these proverbial meat grinders, right? And go the way of the pigs. I mean,
that's probably preemptive.
You're not going to win, and I don't think he's telling you.
So somebody else might have a question at this.
we're always happy to take them. Somebody? We like to disagree, so you have to ask us a question.
Yeah, well, yeah. They're afraid of triggering another 20-minute...
Anyhow, let me now give the following, since we have run our course and some of us they have all to sort of lease. The Barb and Richard show will be on in this room again next week on Thursday because he gave me such a difficult time the last time we were on a panel together that I thought the appropriate thing to do was to ask him to give the Hayek lecture. And he's going to talk about the Hayekian judge.
And you don't get to interrupt me when I give the lecture.
I certainly do not. I get to introduce you. I just wanted to tell them all one anecdote about this man's judicial independence. I asked him for a subtitle so I could figure out how to pitch my opening remark, which he declined to give me. So it remains a Hayekian lecture, and therefore you have to come to find out what these words should appear after the colon. Okay, thank you. The federal tradition on this is different.
Oh, yeah.
The level of deference given to the source.